This is what I have. People use. And if I were to re-implement the graph, they couldn't tell.
No. It's now?
No.
Now it's better?
No.
Do I have to start from scratch? Okay. So again, first example, shared pointer. We declare shared pointer, we create a resource, and then we declare another shared pointer. And you here see the first important thing, which is a shared pointer does not come for free, unlike a unique pointer, by the way. A shared pointer has a control object because we have to implement the concept of shared ownership, and somewhere we have to manage the when the last owner deletes this resource, which is a control object which is created on the heap by calling malloc or new, and this costs something. What it exactly costs, we will see later. So then when we assign this to another shared pointer, this object, we have in this control object two owners. And now if I, for example, print how many owners I have, I can use the global pointer or the shared pointer who initially took the object. Both will print two. And then when I leave the scope where the inner shared pointer, the initial shared pointer, was in control, the initial shared pointer leads to a decrement of the number of owners. And when I leave the whole scope, then with the last shared owner owning the resource gets destroyed. I hope we all know that. No? Yeah?
What's the dotted line?
The dotted line means that it's questionable whether or not we have a pointer from here to there. It's in principle, as far as I know, possible not to have it, but it's in practice, it's usually there. Somebody wants to correct me there? Yeah. But always, well.
Because it's a type array,
really.
The control block has to
remember
the original type array.
Ah, for type array. So, okay. So I will replace a dotted line by a. By a solid line. Thank you.
But the control block may have been allocated at the same time the resource was allocated.
Wait. You're too fast. This scope is too fast. Okay. So, and what you all know, we can define what does it mean to delete. To a free resource, and we can define all the deleters. I don't think I have to explain details here. Okay, so then we have the concept of a weak pointer. Weak pointer is necessary in this concept to avoid cyclic dependencies or to have just observing pointers where you have some ownership, but you are not. It's not your fault that there are still. That the resource still exists, or what Scott Meyer says, and we don't have the disadvantage of a raw pointer that we don't see when the resource no longer exists. So it's in fact a raw pointer that knows when it dangles, what quote by Scott Myers. And you can use it similarly. Let's look at a detailed example. Here's a weak pointer declared on the outside, just an observer. And then we have internally another shared pointer and the third shared pointer. Now in one statement we create the resource and then the control block. We assign the shared pointer to the other shared pointer, and we assign the shared pointer to the weak pointer. And here you see another important thing. It's not that we only have one counter, we have two counters in the shared pointers, because we have to not only know when the last shared pointer is deleted, because that's the moment when we have to delete the resource. We also have to count when the last weak pointer has to delete it, because we need it to manage the dangling problem. So does it still exist, the resource? Alistair?
I don't believe the weak pointer needs to point to the resource.
Okay, so here's a dotted. So here's a dotted line then. I learned more than.
If there was any line there at all, you can't obtain the resource through the weak pointer.
Okay.
You always have to look and get a shared pointer back through the control block that in turn will give
you. Yeah, okay. Yeah.
But no, I think you can also, the weak pointer can also be cast.
The there's no direct access from the meeting to the resource. You always have to turn it back into a shared pointer.
So the question for the audio is, well, the first question was, do we need this pointer? And the argument was one argument that it's always there because of type deduction and to know the original type of the resource. And the other thing is that the weak pointer does not necessarily need this reference because it refers to the control object, and by this we can use. But then there was the comment for the same argument for type safety, it might be a problem then.
When you lock the weak pointer, you don't get the original resource. You get the resource controlled by the weak pointer, which might be a different type from the original resource.
Okay. So the interesting thing is when you use a weak pointer, you first have to do something like calling lock to get then the handle for the object. But this lock returns a shared pointer.
If I understand correctly, it's because we've not spoken about the aliasing facility yet, and that is what would cause. Okay.
I don't repeat that comment. Excuse me, English is not my native language. So sometimes it's C++ is a problem, sometimes English is a problem. And if both comes together, then it's a nightmare for me. Okay, so again, we leave the scope. So the decrement of the number of owners, we decrement the number of owners. And that's the moment where we call the destructor or the deleter for the resource and free the memory. Or whatever the deleter defines, but we still have the control block, and then when the last weak pointer gets destroyed, then also the control block gets destroyed. That's the behavior. So you see here already that the overhead for a control block is one pointer and two counters, so something like 12 bytes. Okay, so we introduced something new. Beeman asked for that already. Probably you meant that. So we said, it's a common way that we allocate the new resource with new, and then we allocate the control block resource with new, or whatever is internally loaded, but on the heap again. So this sounds not very useful because it's one of the most expensive calls we have by allocating memory. We introduced something called make shared in C++11, and this does both creating the resource and the memory object. Let's see what this change or what the change behavior is. So when I call make shared with just one internal memory call, we create the resource and the control block. And by the way, this also allows us to assign the result to an object declared with auto because the type is deduced then. And then the usual thing happened, and we have the assignment increments the numbers of owners. When we leave the scope, the owner gets decremented, the count, and now, here's missing some step. When the last block is left, then the whole resource and the control object are destroyed together. So that's interesting. If we use then weak pointers, then we have an interesting consequence of this behavior. So again, let's create the shared pointer with the make shared. As I said, we have one call to allocate the memory for both the control object and the resource. So we can no longer free the memory of the resource independent from freeing the memory for the memory object for the control object. So that means that if we assign this shared pointer to another shared pointer and to a weak pointer, we have this situation. And then when we destroy the first shared pointer and then the second shared pointer, the resource is destructed. So the destructor is called, but the memory is still there, which, by the way, might be a problem. So it's not always true that it's better to use make shared, because if you have still a weak pointer referring to that, the whole memory of the whole resource is still allocated until the last weak pointer gets deleted. So keep that in mind, please. With the last weak pointer, the memory as a whole gets deleted. On the other hand, with the direct make shared concept, we save one pointer. So the overhead is usually less. for the control object. We have the concept called enable shared from this. Who has heard about enable shared from this? I always wondered. Or who does not know? Okay, yeah. You should know it, because from time to time when we use shared pointer, we have the following problem. We create a new person, for example. We assign this to a shared pointer. And later on, we create or need a new shared pointer, but we only, for some reason, have the pointer to the original object, not the other shared pointer. A special example where this happens, if you want inside the class person create a shared pointer, because inside the class it only knows itself and its address, so this. So to create a shared pointer for this, you have a problem. And if you just do nothing, then you have a big problem, because creating two shared pointers for the same memory means we have two control objects, and that means with the deletion of the first control object, the resource gets deleted and you have a big problem. So what was provided here by the standard is a base class called enable shared from this. Let's see more in a concrete example. It looks like that. What this means is that in the base class, you add a reference that can refer to the shared pointer, but only if it exists. It does not exist until you have, for the first time, initialized a shared pointer with this object. So the moment you create a shared pointer or initializes with this object, then the control block, as usual, refers to there. Plus, inside the object in the base class, there will be installed a pointer to this control block. And that means from the object itself, we can go to we can create a new shared pointer which shares the same control block. So that means when we here now, for example, call get pointer, or I could also have just use pp, or I could, here get pointer, we call a member function of this object, and this returns shared from this. So inside the object, we only have the pointer, we create a shared pointer from that, and that exactly creates this situation, which we assign to the pointer to the outside. So whenever you have this problem, you only have the pointer and not a shared pointer, the original raw pointer, especially inside your class, think about enable shared from this. There are some problems with enable shared from this, especially if you have inheritance and multi-inheritance, then there can some interesting things happen. I skip this because we have other things to tell. Just the price, yeah?
Just a question. What happens if you call shared from this and there is no existing shared pointer?
I don't know. Probably exception, I would think. Does somebody know? The question is, what happens if I call shared from this and there is no shared pointer already assigned?
I think it's undefined, but I'm not sure.
I believe it's undefined.
It's undefined?
Yeah.
Are you sure? I don't think so. Well, everything is possible. We have to look in the standard. But anyway, okay.
According to Boost, the conflict, by the way, there must exist at least one shared pointer instance P that owns T when you have an enable shared pointer.
Yeah, that's
true. I forget what happens when you call it, because I think CD is just a branch.
Yeah.
Because I think CD is just a weak pointer.
Yeah, CB in fact is a weak pointer, yes.
And I think enable shared, when you say share from this, it tries to lock the weak pointer. And if it gets null, I think you get an assertion failure.
Yeah, I think that's guaranteed. I think it's not unspecified behavior. You get a detected problem. So some exception of any kind. Let's see, maybe we find it immediately in a standard. That's my task. My task is to translate the standard to you. That's why I write the books. The problem is I might fail. Enable shared. No.
It is undefined behavior.
Yes?
Yeah, there's a precondition on shared from this. There's surely
there shall be at least one shared footer instance P that owns address of T.
Yeah, there you go. And I think in practice, I think like GCC asserts out, and I think Clang does the same.
Okay. I trust you.
Unless you compile with dash N.
As usual, you have to know what you do in C++. Okay, I'm not sure whether I like this, but anyway. Good. So, having introduced the concepts and to some extent the typical implementation of a shared pointer, now we can make some assumptions and some discussion about what is the price of a shared pointer. The first price we know is we have a control object, we have to create it on the heap, and unless it's created with me together, and this control object needs just memory. So typical numbers are 16 bytes in GCC, Clang, and Visual C++. 20 bytes, interestingly, in Visual C++, 2013, if a deleter is defined. So when they have a deleter, they create internally a different object that has a different memory. I measured this on a 64-bit machine with Sigwin, with a 32-bit Sigwin. So I'm not sure I can answer this question. Do you know?
No, I was going to ask another question about the whether you know if the size of your deleter was 4 bytes, or whether it was dynamically allocating another object to manage a deleter. I'm surprised that we can say it's 20 bytes.
Oh, okay, that's right. The question is, it's not clear that we need this additional 4 bytes for the control object or for some other resource that we allocated. I don't know. I just didn't check in detail the source code. I just wrote a program and looked what the memory consumption is if I do that.
Not quite what I was saying. I was assuming that if I got a large deleter, the whole in our implementation, the deleter goes into the control block. So I'd have thought that if you've got a larger deleter, that could be a sign that Visual C++ is storing however large a deleter is as part of the control block.
Ah, you say that sometimes you have the overhead of a deleter. Depending on the size of the deleter, it might already also be the case for G++, etc. Okay, good to know. Mm-hmm.
And the fact that that overhead is exactly 4 bytes, i.e. exactly the size of a pointer, it implies to me that what it's really storing there is a pointer to a heap allocated.
The comment was it's a smell that it's just 4 bytes. It seems to be like there is a pointer, and this is probably a pointer to what was it to the
somewhere else
where I can find the information about the deleter object. Beeman,
be a little careful about that with Visual C++ 13 because I believe they went through their implementation for 15 and have cut the size of many of.
Yeah, so be a little bit careful on these numbers. Yes, that's why I wrote here exactly the version. However, the versioning of Visual C++ is crap in any sense. So sometimes it's called Visual Studio 2013 or 2012. The compiler's number is 18. So this was compiler C++ compiler 18, which I tried out.
Yes, another possibility, it could just be that you've got an empty base optimization. If you've got an empty deleter type, that it's holding on the G++ and Clang libraries, but Microsoft might not have that optimization for that 2013 implementation.
To avoid all the speculation, STL has actually put a couple presentation together on how the Visual Studio shared pointer stuff is put together, so you can go watch it.
What? Say it again.
STL, Stefan Lovelweight, has put together a presentation on Channel 9 some time ago.
Okay, so there's somewhere an explanation by STL, the programmer of Microsoft, where I can read the details about that. And by the way, I tried out first, without just measuring the memory consumption, to follow the code. It was a nightmare, just for me as an ordinary programmer, because we have a lot of indirections, we have a lot of derived classes that abstract things, different things, and it's not easy to find out what's really happening and used in practice. What I can say, and I hope that's at least true, it's that using makeshared, not surprisingly, usually saves 4 bytes in the test programs I use. But as we said already, we don't need the pointer to the object because we know the object is right behind the control object. And in deriving from enabled shared from this typically adds additional 8 bytes to each object. That's not a promise, it's just what I measured. Okay, so then we have another thing, and that's and now we're coming closer to the discussion, how should I pass a shared pointer? And that is, what's happening when we deal with shared pointers in concurrent situations? So guess, for example, I have a shared pointer, SP, and in one thread, I say I want to push this shared pointer in a vector of shared pointers, and in another thread, I process this shared pointer, I don't know, whatever I use with that. This was discussed, by the way. This was not clear when shared pointer was standardized first, or when the standardization was ongoing for C++11. You can read it here as library working defect 896. And the decision, which you can read in the standard, but it's a little bit hard to find if you don't know that it's formulated that way, like that, is changes in the use count of this control object do not reflect modifications that can introduce data races, which to some extent means that dealing with increments, so with copying and deleting shared pointers, does not introduce a data race. That does not mean that shared pointers are atomic. It's only in this area we are safe. If you just have concurrent access to the shared pointer itself, object itself, for example, by resetting a shared pointer in one thread and asking for the use count in another thread, that's definitely an error. We also try to deal with that in the standard. We created an interface with global functions called atomic store, atomic load, atomic exchange, etc., which is to some extent very dangerous. For example, you get no error if accidentally you accidentally don't use this atomic version to access your shared pointer instead of an ordinary way to deal with it. So there's a new approach for that now for C++17 underway. It's part of the concurrent CTS. And this is a type called atomic shared pointer, and by the way, corresponding types, atomic weak pointer, atomic unique pointer. The most important point is now, as it's a different type, you can't confuse you forgetting the atomic somewhere, because it's a different type, it's a type error then, yes?
Atomic unique pointer died 2 weeks ago, or last week.
Atomic unique pointer died 2 weeks ago. Well, last week there was a standardization meeting. Okay, can you tell me why? Or?
It was strange with an atomic interface. There was no known usage for it, and it was causing controversy when everything else was all set to go to publication. So we're waiting for someone to come back with a real use case for it.
Okay, so it died, says Alistair, because nobody needed it. No, nobody had a use case.
And the semantics felt confusing, the atomic with the unique.
And the semantics of atomic combined with unique was not clear what it means.
I can't imagine, when would you ever want to atomic operations on the pointer that you're not supposed to be sharing?
Right. So this guy confirms this decision, and he says this committee decided wisely. Yes, we did. Yeah, in this case, I say we. Okay. Yeah.
Although, Katrina, that's not totally obvious because they're two unrelated things. The thing that is unique is not at all the thing that is atomic. Yeah. There's a unique thing out on the heap that's managed by this pointer. But a whole bunch of people, a whole bunch of different threads have handles to this pointer, which is why they need it to be atomic.
If you have concurrent threads, unique pointer just means that there's a single reference cell to that object. The problem is that we can have multiple threads that access that reference cell and get access to the underlying object. So even though the pointer multiple people can still access the underlying object.
Okay, for the audio, some discussion whether it does make sense to have atomic unique pointer and under which conditions. By the way, in the paper that introduced or proposed this, N4162, which you can Google for, there is a reasoning example why it should also be there for unique pointer, though there should be at least one argument you can also find. And by the way, this paper also contains an example implementation of using these atomic shared pointers of an improved concurrent stack. And that might be of interest for you if you need something like that. Okay, so let's come back to the problem of incrementing and decrementing a shared pointer. So the standard guarantees that if the use count changes, so if I get a new owner or if I lose an owner, that's not creating a data race. Naively, you can argue, okay, that's okay because we simply use atomics for the counters and that's it. And as a counter is usually something like an integer or I don't know, yeah, probably an integer is enough because we won't have more than that number of owners in most places. And also, and as in most platforms, integers are by definition or by default atomic, which is not guaranteed, but it's the case on most platforms. There is no problem with that.
Well, what do you mean by integers are guaranteed to be atomic on most platforms?
Well,
x86, it's not guaranteed to be.
Yeah.
You can lose data, but if like never give the corrupted data.
Well, you can lose counts.
Okay.
Yeah. So you might not get garbage.
So let it formulate it. The criticism was, what do you say by most platforms? How could you say that on most platforms an integer is atomic? And you're right, it starts already with when I have 32 bits on 64 bits platforms.
My point is that the access to the integer may be atomic, but the increment and decrement certainly are not.
You say the access to the increment might be atomic, but the increment and decrement are not.
It's remodified, right.
So even on x86, there's an instruction to increment and decrement an integer location, but that is not atomic unless you put the
Okay. So you say it's not enough to have atomic because also the operation has to be atomic, the increment operation. Okay. Alistair?
The common issue is when I've got, if I'm working on two threads and they're currently on two separate cores, the integer could have been in the cache lines of the two.
We come to that. That's the whole point. That's what's coming now. So this is not the only problem, and we have another problem. And the other problem is the problem of reordered statements.
Do you mean that there's? But aren't they on a single data line, a data location? Aren't integers guaranteed to be on a single data location? Meaning when they are.
Yes,
they're not like a bit set or
So an integer. So to be precise, right? The integer. I don't know exactly what C standard guarantees, but if you go to
the memory
model, but when you go look at how that gets compiled, like for example on x86, it's an integer. It's a single cell, so you're not going to get partial writes as long as it's an aligned write.
Right.
So you won't get a part of a write from one and a part of a write from the other. But
yeah.
The problem is that the read modify write operation of an increment or a decrement is not atomic, and so you can lose increments or decrements unless you set the lock flag on that instruction, in which case then the increment or decrement then is guaranteed to be atomic enough.
So to repeat that, the memory model of C++, which is guaranteed now in C++, says that it's guaranteed that such an integer if just different threads access different objects, then there's no problem. If they access the same object and at least one thread writes, then we have a data race. Which is not a problem if you have an atomic, because there's an inherent lock of writing and reading the data. But as you pointed out again, that does not mean that incrementing and decrementing the data does not cause a problem. Okay, but anyway, we have more problems, and this is the point of reordered statements. I want to show you that a little bit. I'm not an expert here. Please correct me again if I shoot wrong. And even worse, or not even worse, I used some slides from colleagues of mine who presented a talk about that, but I found them pretty compelling, and you get the idea of what the problem is. And the problem is that if you have different and CPUs, then we use caches and cache lines. And this can have interesting effects. I show you the effect by using the MESI protocol. Could use any else. It's just because of this is pretty simple, and you see the problem what happens. So guess for example, we have some memory and we have two CPUs, and these two CPUs work on the same memory. Then if one CPU just operates on an integer A, for example, then if it's able to modify this, it needs exclusive access and can modify it and assign, for example, one that it's then it's modified. So these MESI states are the reason for the name of the MESI protocol. So now if the other CPU needs this data, the problem what we have is it has it needs the current state, which is currently in the other CPU. So there's some protocol, I don't go into details, but the protocol in principle says, oh, I want to have write access to this or read access to it. So it gets the data. This costs some time inside the CPU, and then the CPU 0 can increment this value again and has it modified. So there's something ongoing to access data like an increment in like a counter in different CPUs. You have to move the data or the representation of the data from one CPU to the other, and this is called write stall because it takes some time. So this is nasty because when it takes some time, yeah, it costs you performance. So what is the trick? The trick is to introduce post store buffers that are to some extent caches for these writes, and that changes things a little bit but introduces new problems. So here for example we have the same situation, but here we have a store buffer so that the CPU can say I want to write something, I want to change something, but actually the change is not committed completely, so it's postponed in a cache which does it later when it is able to do so. So let's see what this means in practice, and let's see by the example where the left CPU sets A to 1 and then ready to true, and on the right CPU we have a loop reading ready, and then assuming when this loop is ends, then A has a value 1. So in other words, when we after this loop process A, it has a value written here because this value was written before ready was set to true. And the usual assumption is that this is valid C++ code, it will compile and it will work, but it won't, or it will not necessarily work. So what happens? Guess this thread wants to check whether the result is ready. So the ready is currently not here, so we need access to ready. So we send a message saying, okay, I need ready. Why this need is going to this CPU? This CPU is setting A to 1 and ready to true. Okay, now, but this happens only in the buffer, in the store buffer here. And now the interesting thing is that the buffer can see, oh, I have ready already with exclusive access. So that's good because I can immediately process this second statement, but this means it overtakes the first statement. So it will set this ready to true, but still it hasn't updated A, which has no side effects outside this thread. It's not a problem, but of course in combination of this will cause a serious problem because now we can get this change ready and we can check it again, and if we check it again we see here that ready is true but A is 0, and that might happen conceptually. I probably missed a couple of details.
So to be more precise here, so it doesn't necessarily have to do with store buffers or caches. You can actually have these problems without either of those artifacts. It depends on the memory consistency model that the processor is going to guarantee in these cases. So for example, in x86, in this particular example, this can never happen because of the store ordering guarantees on the memory consistency model. There's a separate question of what the memory model is for the language, because the compiler may also reorder the stores if the language's memory model allows it. So the question is the compiler allowed to reorder A equals 1 and ready equals true or not? And that's a question about the memory model that is presented by the standard. Again, I'm not an expert on the C++ standard memory model, so I don't know whether that reorder is allowed.
No. It's a little bit different. Just to summarize what you said, it's not necessarily that way. There are platforms where this can't happen, but for example, the compiler can reorder statements. And in fact, both can happen. And the C++ standard does not forbid that. It says even if it's detectable from the outside, only the reordering of statement is allowed to happen in both in the compilers and in the CPUs. As long as it's just local visible, not locally detectable in the thread. And what we have in the standard, we can program against that. And if we program against that, then it's for generation of the code, it depends whether we know that the platform does not reorder statements, then we don't have to create something. But if we know that this reordering can happen, and it must not happen, due to some other guarantees we have, then special code has to be generated to forbid this reordering. And that's a combination of compiler and CPU used. Yeah, fences, barriers are used there. Yeah, I'm not an expert here. The important thing is to make clear to you that reordering of statements can happen inside the CPU, and with the compiler, and even inside the CPU. And that's a very important optimization technique in CPUs, because it means they can fulfill writes immediately or a lot earlier than other updates, and with this general behavior, programs are optimized a lot, but it can cause problems here, and in this case it's a problem. And the same problem is happening when you deal now with a shared pointer. You also need these memory barriers, because you have to know that in some extent with some exchanges of the increments and the decrements that there can't be a reordering you need. So we need something like memory barriers, or fences is another, it's another word or another concept?
I think M-fences, the instruction in x86 that implements a memory barrier.
Okay, so fences is an implementation of memory barriers in some platforms. Okay, good. So with memory barriers, this can't happen. Here's just the idea of the code. So you read the data, but now you have here a write barrier. So you can say just only write calls have to keep the order, can't overtake each other. And then it's guaranteed that this does not work. So you first have to update the A, and then you have to update the true, and then you get both, and then everything is fine. And by the way, for the same reason, you might have read barriers for invalidation of this concept. So in both areas, overtaking commands, changing the order, are possible in both directions for writing and reading data. So both barriers might be there. Yeah. Whatever you. The command was you need a fence of volatile or something like that. Let's not discuss the details, because I'm not the right person to discuss these. I just want to show you what's behind the scenes, and there's something ongoing that leads to reordered statements, and that we have to deal with that. Okay. Good. So let's test and measure. Because that means it's not enough just to have an atomic type. There's also happening more. There's code generated that leads to the fact that we have to exchange the data. And even when we exchange the data, we hinder some optimizations in the code. So I wrote a little program, or my colleagues wrote a little program, more or less doing the following. Create a loop. By the way, I have to check for time. Oh, we have plenty of time. Good. We have we can start threads that call this function. This function is just a loop passing num iteration times a shared pointer. And this passing of a shared pointer can sometimes happen with the reference, sometimes without. So I have both versions in the program. So I sometimes pass the shared pointer by value, and sometimes I pass it by reference, which means the shared pointer is not copied, it's just referred to. Inside the program, every 10 million calls of this will print a message. That's a program. So that's the heart of the program. So let's compile it. Oh, here it is. No. But let's compile it. Let's take the first favorite compiler. I don't know. .50. That's GCC 50 or 451. And let's run the program. In the program, I can see, I can define how many threads I start who are performing this. And I can say how I want to pass the shared pointer. So I want to pass, I want to use one thread, does a loop, and I want to pass the shared pointers by value. Oh, damned. I have to take another version, sorry. Let's take this version first. So this is GCC G++ 448. And here you see, let's measure it maybe. That's a rough measuring how long it took. OK, something like real time, 5 seconds. So now let's call the same program passing the shared pointers by reference. There is a slight difference. I mean, this is an observable difference. This is just one thread. We will increase. So let's start it again. This looks like a factor of 10. And let's just for the moment compile it with, this was compiled without 03. So let's compile it with 03. So it's not 5 seconds, it's 1.3 seconds. That's on my laptop here, it's four core Intel. And now let's call it by reference. Looks also a little bit faster. Let's finally use virtual C++. Yeah, 2 seconds with W4, so big optimizations, also faster. You can see an effect already. The interesting thing is now, let's do the same by starting 4 threads using all the same shared pointer globally among all these 4 threads. Now let's, maybe we start with this directly. So let's use 4 threads and call them by value. It takes a bit.
Now you're doing 4 times the computation.
Yeah, I'm doing, I'm right. But this is more than 4 times the time. So we had, this is a value version of the last compiled program. So we had here the value, this was the value button, it had 2 seconds. And now we have almost 18 seconds. So this is more than 4 times 2 seconds. And that's exactly what you see. You have now the overhead of moving these data around with the memory barriers. And now let's do the same by reference. That's it. We have a factor of, well, oh my goodness, 100? Something close. Close to 100.
So as a note, by the way, the overhead is a lot more than just, the memory fence is really expensive because if you, here you're only updating one cell, but you may actually be forced to serialize all the writes in the store buffer,
yeah,
which are for lots of other memory that are cache misses. And so you end up with a much more, it could be much more.
Yeah. That's exactly what, I also learned. So what he was saying is, yeah, you can see by this difference that it's not just a factor of four, that there's some additional overhead. And one is that we stall, that the impact of the fences is that even some other writes are impacted here, although I don't do much things here. I will show you some more details numbers later. I just want to show you also the same effect now with the optimized GCC version. That's GCC 4.9. Let's start first by value. Almost 18 seconds. Again, it's pretty much the same lessons, and yeah, here it's a little bit slower, but it's a similar factor. So, Marshall, I know I would guess in some programs this difference might matter.
Yes.
Okay, that's good.
Something that a shared pointer holds and still have access to the shared pointer. If you're not going to do anything with the shared pointer, you can pass the underlying pointer just to the object.
Oh, so he's, okay, Marshall was commenting now, yeah, this is a rare case where I really want to pass a shared pointer. Isn't it better to pass a raw pointer when I just need the data? We come to that in a moment.
Okay. That does not have any synchronization, and it saves us about 15% of the total performance. Because even when you pass by reference, there's actually a cost when you don't, and so it's actually significant for us.
So you said that you have in your code base you have an optimization for shared pointer that are only shared inside one thread, and then you even have an effect of improvement.
Once you do that, if you don't do that, then you lose 15% performance.
If you don't, so
normally you're going to have synchronizing instructions for the shared pointers. We have a version of shared pointer that doesn't do any synchronization because we know those shared pointers are only used in the
Okay.
And that gains us 15% performance.
Okay, so you gain 15% performance if you, because of knowing that the shared pointer is only used in one thread, you don't add you don't have the synchronization part of it.
Doesn't boost shared pointer also have that
kind?
Yes. So we use boost shared pointer and we have the right options, even though it's threaded code. We set the right options so that we get rid of.
You said boost. What boost has that? What has boost?
Shared pointer. You can tell it to not use atomics.
You can tell boost shared pointers not to use atomics.
You can tell boost compile in a non-threaded version, and that's basically what we do.
Okay.
Even though we have threaded.
You can also just do it just for shared pointers.
Yes.
SP non-shared. You know the whole reason to pass by reference is to avoid the, you know, the what's called a reference counting mechanism. So you know someone can hold the reference, and then the other reference can go away, and then you will have a decorated pointer. So you know,
wait a minute. No, that's my talk. So the question is, isn't this more dangerous when I pass it by reference than without?
Yeah.
Yeah, we come to that.
Okay.
Here first another measurements we did, and the reason we did that is this is a company called Pastrin. As I said, they are developing a big data database. And what this database does, it memory maps the data inside the program, and then in a lot of places we need that data, and we use shared pointers to control the data among different threads. And we need a lot of threads. We have problems to control and manage these threads appropriately. So therefore we need shared pointers, and we learned that this database could simply not work without this optimization. So we need this optimization, otherwise we could not scale, because it might work with four threads, but as you've seen, it's already worse. And if we now come to systems where we have 8, 16, or 64 threads, and we run in the same problem, it's becoming more and more expensive. So it's simply, and that's what we see, the system architect told me when he said there are good reasons we passed shared pointers by reference. We started by not doing it, and simply could not use the database any longer. Here are other numbers to give you some more details. Here is just a factor you have just seen, but this was on a Debian machine with 8 threads. But also here you see some other interesting numbers. For example, when calling by value, this program was 82% stalling, and we only had on average every seventh instruction cycle, every seventh cycle an instruction, or we had only 0.15 instructions per cycle. And if we switch to reference semantics, we reduce the stall percentages a lot, and we had an average one instruction per cycle, which should probably be the case. Good. Just a side comment here. In C++ 11, we have introduced atomics, but we not only have introduced atomics using a high-level interface, we also have a low-level interface which deals with memory barriers. So the high-level interface, by the way, guarantees in any case that an atomic operation is also a memory barrier, a full memory barrier in each direction. So that means if you just store, say, ready equals, I store to ready true, then this is not allowed to be reordered, that this comes behind that, or anything behind comes in front of it. How this is solved is a different issue. As said before, if we know the CPU does not reorder statement, we can just generate the code and know the compiler is not allowed to reorder statements. If we don't know that, we have to generate code with memory barriers here, and which is done and is guaranteed by the standard. So from a programmer's point of view, this is safe. If I don't pass here any special statement, just store true, then it's a full memory barrier. And same for loading data atomically. But we can, with additional arguments, relax these memory barriers up to claiming no memory barrier at all. And then the reordering I just described might happen, which it can be okay, which can be not okay. I mean, if just two threads increment and there's no dependency on another object in the program, then it's perfect fine to say this shall create no barrier, although different threads should be allowed to concurrently access the data. So here, for example, we relax a little bit. We say more or less here that writes to data are not allowed to be reordered, that they happen after that, but a write here after that is allowed to be reordered to happen before. And same is here with the load. When we say here memory ordered acquired, it's not allowed to reorder a read before that load, but reads before that load are allowed to be reordered afterwards. And there are some other values for that. This is something for real experts. Who is programming here on that area, on that level? Okay, 3, 4, 5 guys, yeah. I mean, yeah. Good. So, come to a conclusion. I didn't forget the question, what is a problem? Is it a problem to pass by reference or not? We come to that in a moment. So the conclusion for now is shared pointers create an overhead. It's the creation of the control object. It might be created with the object itself, but then by dealing with weak pointers, the memory might be used longer than expected. The overhead is something between 12, 16, or 20 bytes. And then we have the problem of how expensive it is to copy a shared pointer, introduced by the fact that it is guaranteed that copying a shared pointer is thread safe. And then you might consider to pass shared pointers in another way. For example, passing them by reference. Well, the drawback is you have to ensure that the lifetime of the passed shared pointer is long enough. Well, thanks goodness, this program, or what I just showed you, that's a function call. And it's, well, almost impossible to screw this up. So when you inside here, you have a loop calling this function. And the good thing is, we call this function, but during the call of this function, when this function ends, we can guarantee that during the whole lifetime of this function, this object is not destroyed, because it could only be destroyed here in this function itself, but we only pass a reference to that. So this is not unsafe. And by the way, the moment here inside the function, we use this shared pointer to create a copy, then we create a copy of the original object, and this copy gets its own lifetime. Then we have all the benefits of shared pointers. So we have no, according to my understanding, we have no drawback in passing a shared pointer by reference. Now, I would assume a lot of hands. You got first. Okay. The comment was, why isn't it better to pass a reference to printer? Let me defer that a little bit. My first claim is that it's not more dangerous to pass this by reference than by value. That's my first claim. So does anybody want to discuss that with me, Alistair?
I would say you could avoid accidents just by passing by const reference, because you gain nothing by retaining the modifiable access here. You don't want to accidentally overwrite the shared pointer
for sure.
To some bug in your code.
Okay, so you say I should then always declare it by const reference. Yeah, you're probably right. Yes, I didn't think about it when I wrote the code.
So we do this. We pass by const reference. The one place where you get burned by this is so we have a lot of event-driven codes. So we might have an object and have a. You know, what would be a lambda now, but a boost bind on a member function, where that boost bind contains the shared pointer for this, that's stored in the event loop. The callback actually removes the event from the event loop. Now, what's happened is you've got the shared pointer at the top level of your call stack that's being held by this data structure, and you're passing by reference all the way in, so your call stack has all by reference. The leaf here actually removes this. That's the only reference that you have to yourself. You now delete yourself, and the rest of your function runs and is actually using memory after free because you're in the member.
That's what I was
saying. So it's a little complicated. So the way we typically solve that is when that happens on the stack, somewhere when we know that that might happen, I usually do shared pointer me, shared from this, and then you finish your function, and then when you return, everything unwinds and it's okay.
Can you?
Yeah,
that's a problem, because I can't repeat that for the audio.
So first,
I think the problem is again, if you describe briefly the problem. Yeah.
So the problem is basically this. Let's suppose that you have, a data structure
here, right, some table or something, and you have a shared pointer in here, and it's pointing to, you know, your object. And now on your call stack, you call, and you have a method here called m, okay? And you call m here, right? But the way you do this call is, so you call m, right? And it's got a this pointer. But inside of m, you are going to delete this. And here, right, when you do that,
and
inside of m, you're going to delete this. When you do that, you've deleted, this is an object O, so this is O.m. You've deleted yourself, right? And when you do that, now any access to like O.x, any member, is now USAC for free. Now,
this is a shared pointer?
This is a shared pointer.
And you deleted
it
how?
And you've removed this entry from, let's say, a set. So it's a set of shared pointers. You remove this entry from the set. Now, this is really easy to understand because there's only one level of indirection. But the way this can actually happen is that M calls another function, you know, F, yep, with shared from this, right? But by reference, right? But F is taking that shared pointer by reference here. So now the problem is, and F actually does the delete. So now you don't even see it. And so F does the delete, and because you've passed shared pointer by reference, suddenly you come back, return, and now you have USAC for free.
But isn't that a problem of the way you've written M, not the way you've used it?
Yes. But you don't know. But the problem is you don't know.
Yeah.
The problem is this call stack gets deep enough that you actually don't know that this is going to happen. So what you do in practice is F knows that it's deleting this entry. Right? So at some point you find out that this is a bug, and then here you have to realize, okay, that happened, and in M you have to say shared pointer me shared from this.
Right.
And so you hold it on the stack up here, you hold this me shared from this.
Sure, but that doesn't change the problem. Nicolas is saying is that the lifetime.
It's not, the shared pointer didn't come from the stack, it came from the heap.
It's a passive reference, you moved one increment.
Yes.
And you said, you know, in the function, you take it again, you increment by one more time.
Yeah.
That sometimes gets okay, but sometimes, you know, if you put
well,
the virtually,
this is not
the
stack.
The lifetime was guaranteed through the execution of F.
No.
It was only it, when
no.
F returned, and then the expression shared from this.
No, the lifetime
finished.
Is not, the shared,
no, no, no,
the shared pointer is not guaranteed through F because
no,
the shared pointer.
Exactly. So F during
yes.
the entire execution of F, and when it returns,
so this
only
okay.
After,
so this is not quite. This is not quite right. What really happens here is you have the data structure D, and you do D dot P. So this data structure
yeah.
D, you do D dot P. This pointer,
okay, that,
and now the lifetime is not extended because this is on the heap. F goes and deletes this. Now the shared pointer, the object is dead. You come back
yeah,
and you've got
yeah,
a problem.
Yeah.
So you
so
do me shared from this because this.
Many ways
for
yourself.
So,
yeah, but
we do run into this. We think it's worth the price.
When I pass by value, I'm always safe, I would
yes.
say. Not always good. I mean, that's the point. Okay, so, but just let me clarify. I mean that shows clearly what happens. I mean, we can relax that by saying, well, if I don't make any strange things inside this function, which of course you can discuss whether you can detect that or know that, if I only need the object and do nothing else, and it now, because here we do something like we take the shared pointer, which in fact is part of a bigger object, which internally we destroy while we're using itself. So this is a little bit more complicated. And as soon as it becomes complicated with lifetime issues, then it's probably a good thing learning from that to pass by value.
We still pass by reference. It's still worth it.
You pass by.
You do have. There's
yeah.
where we do this because we know later in
okay.
the process that you might have.
So there is some possible problem, and even one working around might be to create a shared pointer from this inside the object
on the stack.
Yeah. Okay. Good. So I think the message is clear. Now let's come to the whole question you have asked again and again, and that's more or less.
Yeah.
Herbs. Guru of the week 91. Herb asks in this question, if I have a function that takes an existing object of a widget as a required input-only parameter. What is the right way to pass this object? It's a widget type widget star or reference, so that was the other question, or as a unique pointer or unique pointer reference or shared pointer reference. And his guideline is use a non-const shared pointer reference parameter only to modify the shared pointer. Use a const shared pointer reference as a parameter only if you are not sure whether or not you take a copy or share the ownership. Otherwise, in all other cases, use just an ordinary raw pointer or a raw reference here. To be honest, I hate that. I know that a lot of people agree, but I think this introduces an interesting new discussion. When is it worth to give up the concept of shared ownership? It's a different discussion. It's not the discussion I gave. I discuss how expensive is it to pass a shared pointer by value. And just to make it clear, my argument is it's not faster to pass a raw pointer or raw reference. And to give you here some example, I prepared another version of this, which is, let's pass it by a raw pointer, which is also in the code. And here you see the effect. It's almost the same.
This is depending when you can access the value.
Yeah, of course. I mean, it's a question, how often do I call get, etc., etc., etc. Yeah. What I want to say is there is no performance, no general performance benefit as in the decision between passing by value and by reference in the question whether we should instead use a raw pointer or reference. I didn't measure a significant difference in the performance.
There's one more direction. So there would be a performance issue depending on your cache because you have to get the shared pointer and then get the value from there. Otherwise,
you have to get the shared pointer, not because of cache. You have to do it either way, because you have to get it out inside the function. Or you have to get it out inside the function.
So the question for the audio was, isn't there an additional overhead when using a shared pointer because I need the get? But the problem is I need the get anyway to get the raw pointer. Or I even start earlier to use raw pointers. And then we come to the interesting question, why and should we give up the concept of shared ownership? And that opens the question, why did we introduce it and how do we benefit from that?
And the answer is clarity of interface.
Clarity of interface. So what
you're saying that I'm going to use it here and I explicitly don't expect it to get shared. So I'm going to pass it into this function, and because I've passed it as a widget reference or widget pointer, I'm telling you, do not share this pointer.
So you say your argument is you say that if you pass a widget a raw object as a pointer or reference, it's clearer, it's a clarity for the interface because you make clear it's not my intention to share this object.
It's not my intention to share
through this path. Okay, but you take the danger that somebody inside the function creates a shared pointer from this raw pointer.
I agree with him, and I have another reason for that. But your comment about somebody inside doesn't make a shared pointer from that. You could also say you take the risk that somebody inside, when you pass a raw pointer, doesn't call delete on it. The convention I try to use, which is not universal, is that passing a raw pointer means
that there are no ownership issues, that the caller, the callee, excuse me, doesn't retain a copy of it, doesn't delete it, and it could be null. Reference means it can't be null.
But the question whether I point a raw point or reference, the only question, can it be null or not?
Right.
Yeah.
But the other thing is by enshrining shared pointer or unique pointer in your interface, you have imposed the burden on the caller to wrap whatever he's got in a shared pointer or a unique pointer to pass it to you. And if he has, say, a stack-based object,
so you say if I pass it by shared reference, you have given the burden to the caller to provide a shared pointer instead of just the address of the object. It's interesting. All these. It's interesting that this is a burden, but anyway, okay.
If the data structure you're using this with happens not to be using shared pointers or unique pointers, then you have to.
Okay, you say there's no overhead if I only use shared pointers everywhere, but if I am anyway using raw pointers or raw objects plus shared pointers, somewhere on the stack I anyway have to deal with this problem. Okay.
Sudden, you know, someone wants to decide to change their implementation and use a different shared pointer object, my function won't have to change its signature or its implementation because I don't care what it's contained in. I just care about the value of the object. So by taking in something by reference, it's just a more general purpose function. It can be used in more situations.
Do you say the function can be used in more situations if I just take a raw reference? Because it can be used in situations where I don't have a shared pointer at hand?
Yes.
Well,
okay.
Not just that.
Okay. Okay.
When the container of that thing changes, so it's not shared pointer anymore, now it's like, you know, some new boost version.
Yeah. Alistair.
A general performance problem we've noticed with shared pointer is back around the TR1 era, people learned that shared pointer was the safe default smart pointer to use everywhere. And once we get to C++ 11 and unique pointer, which does work with our containers, generally unique pointer should be your pointer of choice, unless you have a real reason to share. And there's a lot of overuse of shared pointer by people who just don't think beyond shared pointer is my default smart pointer. Use the appropriate smart pointer, and that will also solve a lot of the performance problems.
Okay. The comment by Alistair was one problem we had with in the beginning of C++ 11, also coming from Boost, is that we are used to use only shared pointers. We had no unique pointers in Boost, and so people were used just to use shared pointers for almost everything. And the important thing is unique pointers create no overhead at all in any resources. It's just that they create the concept of exclusive ownership by type safety and the move semantics. So that in most places where just unique pointer is enough, you should also use only a unique pointer instead of using a shared pointer. So that's another reason not to use a shared pointer, but think more carefully what to use, what is better to use.
Classic example is a factory function. There's no reason for a factory to return a shared pointer when a unique pointer can be put into a shared pointer at the other end of that side you want to store it.
So you say there's no reason for factory function to return a shared pointer instead of a unique pointer. You always have to say almost in any sentence caring about C++. But as I said again, I mean, to some extent, this discussion is an interesting discussion. This is probably a very more heated discussion, but that's not the topic of this talk. I mean, because when is it semantically okay to give up the safety of the concept of shared ownership, and for what reason, and to use raw pointers or references or unique pointers, etc.? My point is here that whatever you choose here, this E, this fifth version, can become a big performance problem instead of all the other versions. So if you consider performance, then all A, B, C, D, and F are good, and E is evil, unless you lose control about the side effects that happens inside these functions. And I'm just an ordinary application programmer, and these people tend to like rules, like always use shared pointers, and it's everything is fine, which is probably not the best rule. I changed here, but I want to see good reasons not to use a shared pointer. We discussed some good reasons, for example, the safety of, for example, being flexible, that people use other smart pointers and are still able to call this function, etc. But what I say is there must be good reasons for that. And what I only wanted to say here is, yeah, think about passing shared pointer by reference or not, or there might be good reasons for passing it by reference. And if you decide then instead to use a raw pointer or reference, then it's also, you have the same effect like here. Another comment?
So I think the thing that is being argued is that the only reason that you would use E would be as if you want to consume that shared pointer or make a copy of it.
But
doesn't seem like there would be a reason ever to use that.
Well,
that's the case.
No, but well, you can still consume it here. But you can still use this past shared pointer and create another copy of it.
It's two copies versus one copy, right? So if F is going to copy the shared pointer and you pass that shared pointer, not by reference, now you copy it on the call and you copy it inside of the call. Whereas if you pass by reference, you don't copy it on the call, you just copy it inside the call.
Yeah, but you copy anyway.
But it's one copy versus two.
I'm saying, like, if you move, whatever you pass in the E.
Oh, if you move, yeah, okay.
I'm saying that's the only reason you would use E, is if you're going to be moving out of that shared pointer coming into it. And F, that being the case, you would never need to call F, because the other A through B would take care of the other situations.
Well, the argument to be made here is this. Go look at other languages that don't manage. What is one of the main things that they do? They stop manual memory management. They have garbage collection. Why? Because reasoning about memory ownership is really, and lifetime is really hard. So if you use shared pointer most places, then you don't have to do that reasoning. And yes, you'll pay a small performance penalty to get it. Yes, you don't deal with circular references correctly. But it's still better than use after free in production that you can't debug because it happens once a year to some customer and they're mad.
I agree with everything you said after the part about reasoning about memory lifetime being really difficult.
Yeah, I totally agree.
But also with what Alistair said, if you have no intention to share something, a shared pointer is not the right tool.
Right.
It was the right tool back in the day when auto pointer was kind of limping along, but now we have unique pointer. And unique pointer does the right thing.
Yep.
If you're not going to share it. And you don't have this kind of limit.
Yep. I just want to point out, yeah, first of all, again, summarizing what we said, but I just want to point out another thing. If I pass a shared pointer, I still are able to create a weak pointer out of it and deal with that. So if inside the function I want to create an observer for this resource, a safe observer, which sees when it dangles, then this is possible. If I have a raw pointer only on the resource, that's lost. That opportunity is lost unless I have enabled shared from this used. So that might also be an important thing. Not in the case, in the simple cases where we just call F, it uses, I don't know, two members or call three member functions and that, and then that's it. Then probably everything is fine here. Yeah.
I just want to ask the audience, like, between C and D, if C is there, why would we ever need D? I mean, you can either use A, B, or C.
The question was, why should I ever use D if C is there, because we have move semantics with the unique pointer?
Or we can use A or B, right, if you want the pointer of the reference.
Oh, so the question was?
You have A, B, and C, why you need D?
Why do you use these D instead of these three?
Yeah.
C is the same, D is not a same.
Oh, this is.
D is there because Herb needed one to be
there. No, no, no. Here are missing some other discussions like unique pointer ref, so R value reference. And this will be a different talk. And for that talk, we should have on stage Herb next to Scott. Because they have totally different meanings for them. But I just want to point out, because I told it on Monday in another talk, the interesting problem with unique pointer here by value and unique pointer by R value reference is unique pointer by value guarantees that the ownership is taken. Also, it doesn't look like that. While unique pointer ref does not guarantee that the ownership is taken, although the contract lets you assume that this is the case. So we have screwed up something here in C++. I'm pretty sure about that. Just here, also here, yes. Yeah, but as I said, this is a different talk. So I think I'm done. I hope I helped you to understand a little bit more, or just the discussion here to clarify things for me. I learned a lot again. So thank you very much.